What up, HyperChange? Welcome to another episode. Today, we're talking about a new report from Bloomberg that surveyed 5,000 Tesla Model 3 owners, an incredible amount of data. Shout out to Bloomberg for this report. It's probably the most comprehensive amount of customer feedback data organized beautifully in a ton of charts that we've ever seen from a third-party source. So I think as a Tesla investor, even potential customer, this is going to be some really interesting stuff to see how Tesla's reliability and service and customer satisfaction have been changing over time, because I've poured this through this report and it's given me more and more confidence than ever that the pace of innovation, the rate of improvement of Tesla's manufacturing operations are significantly outpacing every other legacy automaker, and they're rapidly becoming a best-in-class company in terms of customer satisfaction, service, reliability, and all these things are moving in the right direction, and this Bloomberg report proves it. And let's just jump right into this Bloomberg report. You can go to the URL here, bloomberg.com/graphics2019 Tesla Model 3 survey, or just Google it. You'll be able to get to this report. I love the way it's laid out, just super interactive, easy. 5,000 Tesla owners told us what Elon Musk got right and wrong. Quality and reliability, part one, put out just a couple days ago. Shout out to Tom Randall for putting the work in on this. The largest survey of Tesla owners ever conducted. And I like how we're sort of at this mainstream tipping point. Now more than 350,000 of these cars on the roads. Clearly people know about the early effects complaint early on, a little bit of issues with the whole panel gap things. I like how they explain this. These flaws became a point of fixation for the electric automaker's critics and a source of frustration for some owners. Depending on whom you ask, Tesla just turned out one of the best made cars in the world or one of the worst. So they had all of these owners, 5,000 of them, fill out a 164 item questionnaire, an amazing amount of data that they gathered. So now let's take a look at part one, which itself explores reliability, performance, design, and features. So this is the major stat that they led the article with, and that is perhaps the most bullish and most telling of what's going on. Defects per 100 vehicles within the first 30 days of ownership. How many owners reported defects? We have minor issues, major issues. As you can see, these were pretty steady at about 74 in the 70s and 80s, 70s and 80s every single month in 2018, and then actually hitting a high of 100.1 issues, 101 issues per car in early 2019. This is when they started international deliveries of the Model 3, so that could have caused that sort of a rush in Q1 2019. But since then, as they figured out how to manufacture the car better and better, we've seen month over month improvements down to about 35 issues per 100 cars. And so now I want to put that in context for what that means in terms of the industry, because this record of 35 issues per 100 cars in September 2019 is potentially one of the best in the industry. And if you take a look at JD Power and Associates, who has one of the most similar surveys, although it's over a first 90-day period, this Tesla one is a 30-day period, so keep that in mind. So it might not be an apples-to-apples comparison perfectly, but the industry average reported an average of 91 problems per 100 cars in 2019. Remember, Tesla now, as of September, is only 35 issues per 100 cars. And you might say, oh, in those next 60 days, there might be a bunch more issues reported, so we have to adjust that Tesla number up a little bit. But I think even so, we've seen Tesla go from having clearly more issues reported per car than the industry average to significantly below in the past year and a half. This means at the factory level, at the manufacturing level, and Tesla's been talking about this in their quarterly reports, they keep getting better at quality control, at making the perfect cars and improving on all these little tweaks. I mean, the Model 3 was an entirely new vehicle program in 2017, ramping up to hundreds of thousands of units. That is an incredible manufacturing, you know, operation and feat, and it is extremely rapid growth. And you sort of think the amount of pressure that Tesla had to ramp up their deliveries so quickly early on arguably caused them to make all these errors that led to these problems with the cars. But since then, now that production has been smoothed out, they've gotten much better at it. We're clearly seeing those issues per cars delivered go down significantly and become the best in the industry. Here they break down the defects by different categories. I think the exterior sort of panel gap things and paint were clearly the main one. Then we have interior, far less than half of the average complaints. Electronics and climate, drive system and brake chassis seem to be the best performing aspect of the cars. The panels had paint issues. The rear trunk is misaligned. Once again, this has been the core of the sort of beef, the exterior defects here. But if we take a look at these, the trend in these is also going down as well. And And then I love this sort of, they sort of kind of use this AI like sorting by tag thing to show you guys some of the most popular complaints. Paint chips, cracks, crack in the rear windshield, three small scratches on the paint when delivered, scratch on chrome trim. You know, so it looks like a little minor things. Basically, paint chips and panel gap alignment appear to be the main exterior issues from Tesla's cars, but once again, getting better. On the interior, we've also seen, this is much less complaints than the exterior, but a significant decrease in the rate of those complaints, also a good thing. I guess a lot of scratches, it looks like, window trim, doors rattling. You can check these out on your own time if you wanna go through them more. Then they go through electronics and climate defects. These were some of the most, you know, Tesla's strong point. B-pillar cameras need to be replaced. Not too much important here. Drive and chassis defects. And the main thing I wanted to show you guys with this is the rate of issues over time in all of these categories has been declining significantly. That meaning not just, you know, overall is Tesla getting better, but even when you drill down, every single category is showing strong improvements in terms of quality control. So I think this is a really, really encouraging sign that Tesla's getting better and better. But overall at a high level, Bloomberg says they were kind of surprised with this, that basically drivers, Tesla owners raved about their car. This is something of a paradox found repeatedly in the Bloomberg survey. Many of these owners who dealt with defects in their new Model 3 gave the electric sedan high overall marks for satisfaction. So all the problems have been cosmetic. The car drives like a champ. I think this sums it up perfectly. Yes, the Teslas aren't going to be perfect out of the box. There was a little bit of panel gaps. There's a little bit of scratches here and there, but they're getting it fixed. Those are happening less. But overall, do customers like the product? Yes, they're obsessed with it. These customer satisfaction scores are off the charts. So if we look at this, owners describe Model 3 quality and reliability, you can see very satisfied is clearly over 50% after the first 30 days. Then we have somewhat satisfied, can't recall any issues, no problem, excellent quality, I've had no issues, I didn't notice any abnormal fit and finish compared to other cars, could not find an initial quality or reliability issues. So the majority of people are super satisfied with their vehicle. Even this, which is neutral, are, you know, still pretty solid reviews are the bulk of it. Only here in the very tiny, very long tail, small fraction of cases do we have dissatisfied customers. So I thought just at a high level, this was a beautiful depiction of overall how strong the customer satisfaction is for Tesla. This is one of the most overlooked things that Wall Street doesn't get, that I think the financial media is missing. And that is so, so important if you're an investor looking at this company. Do customers love the product? Are they obsessed with it? Is this, are they ever gonna go back to switch? Are, you know, are they super happy they made that purchase? And the answer is an overwhelming, massive yes for Tesla. You know, the Model 3 had so much hype going into it, hundreds of thousands of pre-orders, extremely high expectations to be the iPhone moment of the auto industry, changed the paradigm for what a vehicle is for the mass market. And that was such a high bar of expectations. But what we're seeing is Tesla has delivered on those expectations and followed through and made customers truly happy. And I think that's so, so important. And so as we can see, they sort of break down the satisfaction here, driving enjoyment. I mean, if you've driven a Model 3, probably a lot of you have, the car is like the most fun thing to drive. It's so tight. The turning is so quick. The acceleration on all Teslas, that instant torque. You feel like you're in a spaceship with the, I mean, anyway, you know what I'm talking about. The Model 3 is such a blast to drive. Battery range, the best in the industry, getting extremely high ratings on that. Interior appearance, very high rating. Exterior appearance, very high rating. Brakes, seats, storage, climate, view of the road, all over 4.75. Interior materials, 4.58. By far, like the least, although people liked it overall, but by far, like the biggest weak point for Tesla here. And I think this is really worth noting if you're Tesla, the quality of the seats. I get that the interior is so simple and a radical departure in design from what you'd expect in the auto industry, but I think there's something a little bit left to be desired if you're paying so much for a car that should feel a little bit more luxury. And I think the data is backing that up. And then, you know, I love these quotes. The car feels like the future. I can never go back. Tesla frequently modifies its cars after sale with over-the-air software updates. These have been used to improve the car's acceleration, battery range, as well as add video games to the car's 15-inch touchscreen. I mean, this is the coolest thing. Tesla is the only digitally native car in the entire auto industry. The only one. This is a huge game changer that we're about to see become a bigger and bigger competitive differentiator for Tesla as they roll out more functionality with over-the-air software updates to their basically Tesla OS, their Tesla operating system that eventually you could see turning into sort of Apple-esque app store sort of platform that allows third-party developers to build different programs for your Tesla. I mean, we have a fleet right now of an install base, about 700,000 to 800,000 active Teslas on the road, active install devices or cars that is soon to be going to millions and millions of active cars on the road with Tesla's OS. And I think once you get into the millions, we're going to have a very strong, compelling financial case for developers and for Tesla to open this up. And so I think we're just getting started on this over-the-air software updates and the long-term functionality and excitement that's going to drive for consumers. But even so already, that is by far the people's favorite part of the car, of the features, 4.87, extremely high rated. The touchscreen gets extremely high reviews as well. Everything else here looks pretty solid. I mean, they're all over 4.35 here, even Sentry Mode security. They've been improving that rapidly, so I'd expect this to get better. Auto windshield wipers, people complain about a lot, like the auto rain sensing doesn't work that well, but I don't know much about that. Voice commands, this is something that Teslas have pretty weak score here. I've used it in a Tesla. The voice commands are really slow. They don't work that well, but because this is the first digitally connected car, because it's digitally native, everything's controlled by software through the Tesla OS. As they continue to update the Tesla OS with over-the-air updates, I think we're gonna see a rapid improvement in voice commands once Tesla starts to focus on this. And I think in the future, voice is gonna be a huge way you interact with your Tesla. I also think a Moonshot Monday I made about this, they should launch like sort of an AI in your car, like Alexa. They should call it Jarvis. So I can just ask Jarvis to do something with the car, even on the app, like, Jarvis, just woke up. Can you heat the car to 70 degrees in the next 10 minutes? Or Jarvis, can you charge the battery to actually 100% instead of 80%? Because we just decided we're going on a road trip. That's even through the app. Once you get in the car, you don't want to be fiddling with the touchscreen if you're driving. Jarvis, you know, put on this song. Jarvis, direct me to the best place to go to eat. And then you can interact with the voice commands that way. So although this is weak now, the way Tesla's cars are set up being digitally native is going to allow for rapid iteration with over-the-air updates to the voice command suite of functionality. And I think this is going to be an area to watch in Tesla vehicles going forward. So now let's go to part two, service and charging. Tesla moves from production line to the repair shop. And so service, which a lot of people have been complaining about, I think this is really worth diving into to see how Tesla's doing here. And frankly, the numbers aren't as great with this one. Customer dissatisfaction with timelessness of service on the rise. And this is because, frankly, the service is at max capacity, a little bit overwhelmed. Tesla's investing to expand this infrastructure as fast as possible. But the bottom line is they're just still overwhelmed. I don't think these numbers are ridiculous, but yes, about 1/5 of customers and rising are unhappy with the service. And Tesla was supposed to make this a priority coming into 2019 because of, I think, a lot of pressure from owners like Sean Mitchell, president of Tesla Denver Club, a friend of mine, YouTuber, put out a lot of content about the dissatisfaction with service, and a lot of other YouTubers did as well. And I think Tesla said they were going to focus on it because of that, but we haven't really seen that improvement show up in the numbers. At least that's what Bloomberg is showing here, with a pretty, you know, steep increase in the dissatisfaction rate. But then we have some people saying that customer service was difficult to get a hold of last year, but is slowly improving. So there is some anecdotal evidence of that going in the right direction. Now, this is really interesting because the mobile service vehicles got an incredibly high customer satisfaction score. I think at a high level, that's really simple. The car comes to you, they fix it, you don't have to do anything. That's awesome if they can fix the problem that way. Just to go into the Q3 letter really quickly, I think it's interesting to note that the service mobile service fleet was an area of huge growth for Tesla, up 93%. Year over year, 10% quarter over quarter. So they're investing heavily in these mobile service fleets, which are getting extremely high reviews from customers. Service and store locations, they've grown at a much slower clip. Once again, they're stopping to grow the retail footprint as much, although I would hope they would be opening a lot more service locations. Customer service online, 3.84. Customer service by phone, 3.77. I think a big thing about this has been, frankly, it's just hard to get in touch with them. There's long wait times. The company's a little bit overwhelmed because they've grown so quickly. The delivery process, this has gotten a lot of mixed reviews, but I think overall the scores here were pretty good. Service dependence, buying process versus traditional dealership. This is something I think a lot of people overlook, that going to a Tesla store, maybe it's not perfect. Maybe it's a hassle. Maybe there's paperwork. Maybe they mix up the dates. But compared to the service, if you go to a normal car dealer where you have to hassle with them, they have to go ask the manager for pricing. You have to drive way out of your way to the middle of nowhere to go to where all the dealerships are. Like, I think the overall experience, if you're buying a Tesla, the pricing is transparent. I mean, that alone, they're not incentivized to haggle. And like, I just think it's a totally different experience and a way, way better one. And that's why it's getting a score of 4.58. But there is room for improvement here, definitely, which I think just comes from the fact they're a little bit overwhelmed. They're still new to this. But I do think there's a new, I'm hearing some new rumors that Tesla's sort of rethinking the way it wants to build service delivery and stores and experience centers, kind of combining them into these bigger Tesla hubs with superchargers. And so I think we haven't seen the end game on what Tesla's plan here is for service, but I guarantee you they're focusing on it and trying to fix it. I also think it's important to keep in mind that the service issue really comes from a result of Tesla's grown so quickly. Their fleet of, you know, just a year or two ago, they had like 100,000, 200,000 cars on the road. Now they're approaching a million. I mean, that sort of incredible exponential growth in your fleet causes growing pains, especially at the service level. But I think they'll iron these out over time. And here's another good stat that shows they're doing that, heading in the right direction. So yes, it's taking longer. If you need a service appointment, that part's not good. But the amount of service appointments per 100 cars is dropping rapidly at an incredible pace. And so to me, this shows that the progress there is although they haven't solved this totally, the progress is heading in the right direction. We're going from, 53, 34 in the 50s here, down to the 30s, down to the 20s, service appointments per 100 cars. And now we're down to just 10 in September. So like almost an 80% reduction here since September last year, maybe even more. So really impressive to see Tesla, what it takes to fix initial defects, average service appointments per 100 cars dropping rapidly. Days waiting for parts. This is something that we've heard a lot of people complain about, and they talked about in the conference call that they wanted to basically improve the logistics of how they got parts to warehouses, making sure they were closer to the service repair shops. And it looks like they've been working on that. That's where Elon Musk tweets this, and as they can see, a little bit of improvements, but frankly, not that many, but it still is heading in the right direction there. This is the other problem, is although there's less service appointments, like we saw, that's going the right direction. Once again, the wait time to actually get an appointment continues to go up and continues to be a huge friction point for Tesla, basically signaling that all of their service locations are pretty overwhelmed. Charging options, extremely high customer satisfaction here. Supercharger availability, 4.5. I mean, the Tesla supercharger network, not only are they the only one in the industry, but customers are saying they love it as well. I think this is a very supremely underrated moat or feature that drives the sales of Teslas versus every other electric vehicle. Satisfaction with charging options. This is a really interesting one because the biggest shift with the ICE versus the EV is how convenient is it going to be to charge? Is it going to be a hassle? And consumers are showing charging convenience versus gasoline cars is extremely high, 4.67. If you're primarily using a home charger, it's way higher. I think relying on a supercharger is a little bit less convenient, so that's why that score is a little bit lower. Supercharger network size, obviously people want it to expand, but overall the ratings and satisfaction with the charging options are extremely high. And I think this is a big misconception of people who still haven't switched to EVs, that it's so inconvenient. But the reality is, if you're already plugging it in all the time at home for your daily driving, it's more convenient. You're saving way more time because you don't have to go to the gas station because you just wake up with a full tank every day. I think that's a huge, huge misconception. This battery range chart is fascinating. A lot of people like to point at the degradation of batteries as a huge negative for EVs, but the data for Tesla shows they are the best in the industry at this and have extremely limited degradation over time. And even with really a lot of battery use, their batteries hold up very, very well. I think this was something I was concerned about, or I think just in general, a lot of people were wondering like, okay, we've never seen this type of battery before. Once we put 10, 20, 30, 40, 50,000, 200,000 miles on it, how is that battery gonna hold up? So this is what the data shows. Here's the 100% level of cars. And then here on the bottom axis, we see the mileage. As you can see, the Model 3, first of all, is containing battery capacity way better than the older generation of electric cars, which I think is really awesome to see that they're improving with the Model 3 battery pack. But as you can see, degradation over time, just 1.45%, 1.67%. This is after 20,000 miles. The median battery decline was just 1% loss in range. Even after 40,000 miles driven, the battery is still holding up well over 95%. So it looks like about a 2.5% decline in the battery range after 40,000 miles. So this is also really encouraging data about the long-term viability and quality of the Model 3 battery. So that wraps up the first two parts of this. They're gonna have a bunch or two more segments of this report coming out soon. They will have the Autopilot report coming on the 5th of November and the Market Evolution coming on the 7th of November. So huge shout out to Bloomberg for putting out that survey. fascinating to get a look at all that data from a third party in particular. But at a high level, I was extremely encouraged by the numbers we saw. You know, Tesla customers are extremely satisfied with their vehicle. The almost consensus is that once you drive one, you never want to go back to the internal combustion engine. You're obsessed with Tesla, the brand, and electric cars in general, and you're sort of been converted. And I think this survey backed that up. And then a lot of the issues that I think the media has reported on for Tesla got way overblown. The panel gaps, the paint issues that Monroe and Associates were sort of laughing at them about. And it was sort of like, yeah, they're rushing, they're pushing out this car they've never built before. But over time, the pace of innovation, the rate of learning at Tesla has led to the data showing that there's been significant improvements in the amount of quality or in the amount of defects per 100 cars is going down rapidly. Used to be way above the industry average, now way below the industry average. So, you know, the pace of innovation at the manufacturing level, at the factory, Tesla is not only pumping out more and more cars, but they're getting better with the quality control of each car that comes off the line as well. And so that can't be understated. The data is supporting this from a service sort of perspective as well. The cars are needing less and less service appointments. So that's another data point to say that the quality is improving and sort of backing up this longer term thesis that the electric cars need way less service and maintenance than the internal combustion engine counterparts. You know, over the long term, I think we're going to start to see more and more data emerge, which I hope Bloomberg does another report on, which is the cost of ownership with the amount of defects dropping, the amount of service appointments dropping. I think Tesla already, from the data that I've seen from people who own their Tesla a very long time, is showing that they're significantly cheaper to operate on a per mile basis, from talking about charging, energy costs versus gas charging costs. We're talking about no oil changes needed, a significantly less amount of moving parts. So the ongoing annual operating maintenance costs of the electric vehicle are significantly lower as well. That'll be a story for another day, but I also think it's just super, super impressive to see this level of data, the rate of improvement. The one thing where Tesla needs to get better is the wait times when those service appointments do happen, but I bet you they're working on that, and I bet you we're gonna start to see improvements in that line as well. So anyway, that wraps up my episode. Would love to know what you guys think in the comments below. For me, at a high level, this was super encouraging data to see that Tesla, yes, we know they had some issues at first, but they've ironed them out and they keep getting better. And it looks like they're some of the best in the industry in terms of quality control right now. It just is a testament to the pace of innovation going on there at Fremont, at the Gigafactory One, and gets me so, so excited for the quality and just the potential of the new cars coming off the line, Model Y and Model 3 in China. Anyway, this is HyperChange signing off. Huge shout out to our Patreon supporters, producers, funding the channel. You guys helped me pay for the Bloomberg subscription, was why I could show you this article. So anyway, I'll see you guys next time. Peace.